Dabar then. So probably you have thought, what is this guy throwing garbage at the audience? Probably this is because we are in a country where no deposit on beverage cans and bottles is implemented. In countries where deposits are implemented, you would have thought, why is this guy giving away money to the audience? Because that's what I want to explain you, how deposit systems can help changing our mindsets and our attitudes to resources that we are used now to throw away. As this Fanta can that I found 2 years ago, and it's more than 30 years old, and it has been there in the mountain. So I'm here. I work professionally in the Foundation for Waste Prevention. It's a Catalan-based organization. We are located in Barcelona, but I'm also involved in many other campaigns. The Catalan Strategy for Zero Waste is one of them. And then there is Retorna. Retorna, it's a Spanish-wide campaign. And it's a coalition of NGOs, of trade unions, of consumer associations, and even of recyclers companies that are pushing at Spanish level to implement a deposit on one-way beverages. And as you can see, we are very happy and we are a very cohesionated team. But what is a deposit? A deposit is a very simple economic instrument to try and help changing the behavior of the general population. And we are very used to deposits, or we were very used to deposits. So probably here in Bulgaria has happened the same that happened in Spain like 30 years ago. We were used to go and buy a Coke or buy a Pepsi Cola and to return the package, the container, in order to be refilled. Back then, it was not that easy to get hold of resources. They were expensive, and you could not throw them away. So even in the bottle, it said, this bottle has deposit money for cash for containers. So they wanted, the producers, the fillers, wanted you to return the container in order to be refilled. And deposits are part of our daily life. Not only in bottles, but for instance, when we go to when we rent a car, we leave a deposit, and when we return the car in proper condition, then we get the deposit back. Or if we go to a supermarket and we get a trolley, we are used to leave a coin. There is a slot for the coin in order to leave a deposit and return the trolley and then get our money back. This is the simple mechanism that has helped that in supermarkets, for instance, there are no more trolleys just around messing, hassling, and they are all aligned and in order to be used. So that's the same idea behind deposit on waste streams. So we put an economic instrument to help people behaving in the way that we can regain and collect resources. I don't know if you know this guy. Does someone know this guy? Let me help you. It's called William Painter. And probably he's responsible that we are gathered here. This guy was the inventor of the first disposable industrial item. He was the inventor of the crown cork and, of course, of the bottle opener, because otherwise you could not drink the content of the bottle. But this was the first industrial disposable item. But what's more interesting is probably this guy. I guess that no one will know him, but if I put you the name, maybe you know. So this guy, King Gillette, was working for Painter, and he asked him, you are becoming very, very rich, and I want to be as rich as you. How can I do it? And Painter said, you have to invent something that is disposable, and it's cheap. So, you know, everybody knows what this guy invented. And this was the origin of our disposal, our throwaway society. This is a picture of the Life magazine in the 60s, and it reflects what disposability, what throwaway society means. Back then, disposability was hailed as the paramount of the industrial culture. So we can produce everything we need, and it's so cheap that we don't have to bother to collect, to clean, or to reuse. So everything too cheap to reuse. But let's go back to deposits. This is probably the paramount of the disposable society are one-way containers. Nowadays, we are using 300,000 million of cans, of beverage cans made of aluminum or of steel, and even a larger quantity of plastic bottles. I'm talking of all the world. That makes more than 40 containers per person and per year. That's a huge amount of resources, of course. And these are too cheap, are so cheap that the companies give them away to us. And we can do whatever we want with these empty containers. And normally what we humans do is throw them away anywhere. Problem, global littering has become a problem. Marine littering, you have seen images of birds, of tortoise eating bags, eating bottles, and so on. So this is a problem, of course. One-way deposits are a problem. And I come, as I told you, from Catalonia, where we use 9 million bottles and cans every day. 9 million bottles and cans, of which we only recycle 3.5 million per day. The other 5.5 million end up in landfills, end up burnt in incinerators, or even worse, they can end up in beaches, in parks, in mountains, creating a global problem. But what happens if we put a deposit on one-way packaging? This is a trend that started in the 70s in the United States, and it has been expanding. Nowadays, 2015, we have 40 countries or regions in the world that are using deposits on one-way packaging. And good news is that every year we have more and more regions. Australia will probably have a national deposit system in 2017. And this year, Flanders, Scotland, and Catalonia have commissioned studies in order to assess the feasibility of implementing such a system in their regions. What are the benefits of deposits? Well, of course, you have higher return, higher collection rates, higher separate collection rates. Normally, for instance, in Spain, we have around 30% collection rates for bottles and cans. If you put a deposit, you can achieve 70, 80, 90, 95, and even 98% return rates. That is what is happening in Germany. Of course, if you can get hold of all this flow of plastic, of steel, of aluminium, of glass, then you are securing raw materials, as Enzo explained us this morning. This is part of the zero waste strategy. Of course, we are reducing littering problems. As I've told you about marine littering, but littering is also not a matter of environment, but also a matter of costs, which is also important in the zero waste strategy. If we have to collect cans and bottles in gardens, in parks, in anywhere in the city, that has more costs than collecting them through a deposit scheme. And this means savings. Of course, when we get hold of material, we can reduce our carbon footprint, energy use, water use, etc. And it's an equitable and it's a fair system because producers are paying for most of the containers that or the packaging that they put in the market. That's EPR, that's extended producer responsibility. So producer has to pay for the waste that its production and distribution system generates. And of course, this means economic savings for taxpayers, because as I told you, we have reduced litter collection costs. We have less need to clean beaches or lakes or any water mass. We have to pay less for landfill or for incineration. And in general, we have less waste collection and treatment costs. Probably, those of you who have talked about deposits with administration or with producers would have told you, but this is an expensive system. Why do we need to create another collection system? That's double cost. That's nonsense. Our CEOs normally use this kind of arguments. They try to convince politicians that deposits are nonsense. But we see that the trend, it's like every year we have more and more countries. And let me tell you, in Spain, we have spent the last 20 years trying to convince population to take part on the separate collection. 20 years of communication, of environmental education, of raising awareness, and we have only achieved 30% collection rate. And let me tell you something. I only need 10 seconds to explain someone how to use a deposit system. It's you will get your money once you return the empty container to the shop. That's it. No 20 years of trying to communicate, trying to convince people. 10 seconds. 10 seconds to rise from 20%, 30% to 90, 95%. And that's what this kind of people doesn't want, because they know that they will have higher treatment cost, and they don't like it. Coca-Cola doesn't like it. Danone doesn't like it. Nestlé doesn't like it. And that's the only reason why we are so slow in implementing deposit systems all over the world. But these people know that this will happen, and this will happen, and this will help, of course, advancing towards zero waste society. So, in summary, deposit system works. It's compatible with current collection systems, and it's necessary. It's necessary because we are too slow advancing towards zero waste. And finally, as I told you at the beginning, deposit is not only for beverages. Deposit is an economic instrument. Deposit is a concept. It's a tool for waste management. And we can apply deposit not only to beverages, but the same idea can be applied to other waste streams that we want to control, that we want that perform good. For instance, the German Council for Sustainable Economy has asked the German government to set a deposit on mobile phones. We are used to change every year, every 2 years, every 3 years. Mobile phones, and you all know that mobile phones are rich, or at least have content of gold, of silver, of palladium, of coltan, of rare earth, of valuable materials, but in so small quantities that maybe you don't bother to return it. Put a container and you will come from 20% collection rates for mobile phones to 90% collection rate. Or batteries, or other toxic waste streams. For instance, in Belgium, in the Netherlands, there is deposit on batteries. So instead of being stuck in 15, 20, 30%, you name it, the amount of return rate that you have in your country, you can achieve 70, 80, 90% per batteries. So I will end up my presentation by asking all zero wasters to introduce in your argumentation deposits as economic tool, not only for beverages but for everything that we want to have to achieve high return rates.
Thank you very much, Victor.